Well, good evening, everyone, and welcome to today's Bombay Psychiatric Society event, which is the first of this sleep and psychiatry interfaces that we'll have. These are going to be a series of webinars where we're going to look at different facets of sleep and psychiatry purely from a clinical perspective to help clinicians understand this better. Today is the first of such webinars, and we have two speakers today, Dr. Ashutosh Shah and Dr. Manasvi Gautam. I assume Dr. Manasvi will join us shortly. Dr. Ashutosh, to introduce Dr. Ashutosh first, it's a proud privilege to introduce him. He prefers to call himself a student of psychiatry over the last two or three decades, and he's still learning. And he's been very much interested in academics, research, neurosciences and neurobiology. He's attached to the HN Reliance Hospital as a consultant psychiatrist, where I also work, and I'm very happy to have him as a senior colleague with me. One of the things which strikes me about Ashutosh on a very personal note is that everyone knows neurobiology. There are a lot of people who know it in detail, and they can very often bog you down, you know, when they talk about neurobiology. But one of the things about Ashutosh is when I listen to him, I feel neurobiology is simple, and I feel like reading neurobiology. That's why I have sort of chosen him for today's talk. And he's going to speak to us about the basic science, neuroscience, whatever things about sleep that we should know as a clinician. He would speak for around 25 minutes, and we'll follow with Q&A for him. And then our second speaker would take over. So over to you, Ashutosh. Please feel free to take the speech.
Yes. So thank you, Avinash, for all the kind words that you have spoken about me. And also thank you for asking me to do this talk, the opening batsman, if I can put it in this series. So few things before I start my presentation. So there's no conflict of interest, but there's a potential disclosure. There is an offer for honorarium, which I'm still considering. So that's the only thing I would like to inform you all. And second thing is, since I'm doing this through the iPad, when I share my screen, video will shut off. So if permit me to not show my face when I'm going to be talking. So these are the two things. If somebody really wants to see my face, I'll have to join in through my phone and show it. But otherwise, I don't think that should be an issue. So let me start my screen sharing. Don't start the timing right away, Avinash.
No. Please.
Okay. So So, Avinash, can I request you if you can see my screen?
Yes, we can see.
Okay. So, I'm going to be speaking on the neurobiology, or as short, biology for busy clinicians, about sleep. And for me, clinicians is everybody, including those who are doing the postgraduate psychiatry, because you're really looking after the patients, and how do you translate the basics into your clinic. So I'll make an attempt over here. So the agenda will be, I'll start off by saying, what is sleep? So a basic definition, what is the function of sleep? And then delve into the brain areas which are involved in sleep and wakefulness, and the mechanism of switch from wakefulness to NREM sleep, and then further to REM sleep. And very briefly touch on the sleep architecture, what drives sleep, and what are the changes in sleep across the lifespan. So this is what the agenda I have set, and it will be covered in around 20 slides from now. So sleep, well, we know that all from viruses to mammals have periods of activity, inactivity. But basically on a behavioral level, sleep is a reversible state of perceptual disengagement and unresponsiveness to the environment. Now the key words over here, it's a physiologic process, it's necessary, it's temporary, reversible, and it's a cyclic process. Now, having seen what is sleep, what is the function of sleep? Now, I've listed few on the slide, but in the words of Dr. Alan Radstaffen, so who was one of the pioneers in over here, he said that sleep definitely would be having a vital function. Otherwise, it will be a big mistake of evolution. So definitely, sleep serves some vital function. Few which we have listed over here is maturation of the neurons, facilitating learning, including facilitation of unlearning, improving cognition, the glymphatic function, that's 0.5 over here, conservation of metabolic energy. But we still don't know what precisely is the specific physiological function of sleep. In fact, people have said that NREM sleep is more to restore the function and well-being of the body and REM for the brain. But these are still not carved in stone and are the subject of research. Now, having seen what is sleep and what is the function of sleep, let's delve into what are the brain areas involved in wakefulness of sleep. So this slide, the summary slide, may I request people to just mute them so that it doesn't disturb the other audiences, please? So these are the brain areas over here. And what I'm going to be requesting you all to remember the acronyms LDT, which is lateral dorsal tegmentum, and PPT, not PowerPoint, but pedunculopontine tegmentum. These are involved in the pons. And then the ventrolateral preoptic area, VLPO, which is in the hypothalamus. So this is just an overview slide. Now coming to the hypothalamus. So I'm going to talk of hypothalamus and brainstem and the finer structures over here, which are involved in sleep. So within the hypothalamus, more precisely the lateral and posterior hypothalamus, you have the sole secreting area of the brain, which secretes hypocretin, which is involved in wakefulness. Now hypocretin 1 and 2, or what is also known as orexin A and B, this is a neurotransmitter which acts on the hypocretin 1 and hypocretin 2 receptors, and it promotes wakefulness. How exactly it does? In a nutshell, so over here what we can see is that this is the location of the ventrolateral or the lateral and posterior area of hypothalamus where the orexin neurons are located, and it connects to the tubulomammary nucleus in the posterior hypothalamus, as well as to the dorsal raphe nucleus, the locus ceruleus, and the PPT LDT. So it stimulates these areas, and also a branch goes to the basal forebrain and again stimulates. Now what these areas are, these areas secrete different neurotransmitters. So the neurons, for example, in the raphe nucleus secrete serotonin, in the locus ceruleus secretes norepinephrine, in the PPT LDT it secretes acetylcholine, and more recently they have found it secretes glutamate. And the basal forebrain, it secretes both GABA as well as acetylcholine, as well as the third one, which is the glutamate. And then it stimulates the cortex and leads to a wakeful state. So orexin or hypocretin is the one which is responsible for wakefulness. And what they have found in animal experiments, the wakefulness and the activity of this orexin secreting neurons is maximum when the animal is in an exploratory behavior, and much less during the other parts. Of course, during sleep, this is quiet. It doesn't secrete orexin. And clinically, when there is a lesion, so when 90% or more of the orexin secreting neurons are destroyed, you have a lesion called narcolepsy. In fact, in patients of narcolepsy, they find that in the CSF, the levels of hypocretin 1 or orexin A are almost absent. And of course, this is narcolepsy with cataplexy. That means a sudden loss of muscle tone. In those with narcolepsy without cataplexy, the damage is little less, but nonetheless, it is there. So this is one of the main areas of the brain involved in wakefulness. So that's the main function of these hypocretin secreting neurons. The second area, which is exactly doing the opposite function, it is involved in sleep, in both NREM and REM sleep, is the VLPO, or the ventrolateral preoptic nucleus. And it secretes GABA and galadin. And what does it do? So this area also innervates different parts of the brain. And over here in this slide, sorry, just a moment. So in this slide, I have shown the areas where it goes. So from the ventrolateral preoptic nucleus, VLPO, there's a connection to the tubulomammary nucleus, and this secretes histamine, and histamine is involved in wakefulness. Apart from this area, a little bit on the medial and dorsal side, you have what is known as the extended VLPO. That means the extended ventrolateral preoptic nucleus neurons, which then innervate the structures in the PPT, LDT, locus ceruleus, dorsal raphe nucleus, and it inhibits these areas. So therefore, it stops these areas from promoting wakefulness and thereafter brings about the onset of sleep. So these are the two main areas. If nothing else, just remember, the main area of the brain involved in wakefulness is in the lateral and posterior hypothalamus, and it secretes orexin. And the VLPO, which is located in the ventrolateral part of hypothalamus, secretes GABA and galerin and is involved in both NREM and REM sleep. So these are the two main areas. Then you have other areas also. So I touched upon this fact of tubulomammillary nucleus. So here you have the histamine secreting neurons, and histamine is involved in wakefulness. And these neurons project to different brain areas as shown on the slide. In return, this nucleus also receives a stimulatory input from the hypocretin secreting lateral hypothalamus. And the activity is maximum during wake, lower during NREM, and absent during the REM sleep. The brainstem area, that's where the neurons producing dopamine are located, in the substantia nigra and the ventral tegmental area. And there is also a group of neurons in the ventral periaqueductal gray, or VPAG or VLPAG. And they receive an cholinergic input from the LDT, orexin neurons, and an inhibition from the VLPO and the prefrontal cortex. Now, the dopamine serves to increase wakefulness and decreases NREM and REM. And when we give dopamine blockers, that's antipsychotic, then it tends to reduce this and promote sleep. So therefore, a side effect of antipsychotics is to have a sedation. Of course, apart from the fact that antipsychotics have multi-receptor actions, some of them may be having antihistamine action, which again will cause sleepiness. And paradoxically, low doses of dopamine agonists like pramipexole or ropinirole, they bind to the autoreceptor and they cause sleepiness by reducing the dopamine signaling. And a corollary, amphetamine or any other stimulant would promote wakefulness, increasing the dopamine signal. May I just request everyone please mute their mics so that others are not disturbed? Thank you. Now, coming to the reticular formation. So this is a group of neurons which is located from the medulla to the midbrain. And you have two systems, the dorsal RAS, or the reticular activating system, and the ventral. And these are chiefly involved in wakefulness and REM, the dorsal RAS. And essentially, it involves the neurons located in the LDT, that's the lateral dorsal tegmentum, and the pedunculopontine pontine nucleus, and projects to the thalamus. And over here, it stimulates the thalamus. Or the lady to mute themselves. Thank you.
And
when the thalamus is stimulated, it in turn stimulates the cortex because of the further connections. And these are essentially cholinergic. And as recently discovered, they're also glutamatergic in nature. So the impulses and the neurotransmitter released from this area towards thalamus are cholinergic in nature and glutamatergic. And thalamocortical rhythm, that's the fast activity that you'll see during the states of wakefulness as well as REM, is generated by virtue of this circuit. During NREM sleep, these neurons over here are inactive. The ventral reticular activating system, this originates in the locus ceruleus and the dorsal raphe nucleus over here, and it projects towards the lateral hypothalamus. And it gets a branch from this tubulomammillary nucleus and then further projects to the basal forebrain. And from the basal forebrain, it goes throughout the cortex. And this is also involved in wakefulness. And a word about locus ceruleus. So this is the main norepinephrine secreting area, dorsal raphe, the serotonin area. And these are involved in wakefulness. Therefore, anything which is anti-epinephrine or anti-serotonin would cause some amount of sleepiness. And a basal forebrain, as I already explained, has cholinergic neurons as well as GABAergic. And now they have even discovered glutamatergic neurons. And when this area is stimulated, it tends to cause wakefulness. So having seen these different brain areas, let's look into a summary slide over here. So when over here, during wakefulness, this wakeful condition, you will see essentially the maximal activity of the hypocretin secreting neurons in the ventral and lateral part of hypothalamus. And during the NREM and REM, you will have the VLPO. Dopaminergic neurons, their activity is not much state dependent, but specifically the neurons in the ventrolateral periaqueductal gray are most active during the wake states. And there is a burst activity going on over there. So this is what I will just end with: the areas involved in wakefulness and sleep. The next slide shows how a switch occurs from wakefulness to non-REM. So we had known that orexin stimulates these structures and brings about wakefulness. And when that happens, these structures have an inhibitory input on the VLPO and the extended VLPO. And therefore, the individual is awake. And as wakefulness is there, there is something known as a sleep pressure going on. That means certain substances in the body are increasing. One postulated is adenosine, which then acts on the VLPO. And subsequently, VLPO acts on the locus cerulus, tubulomammillary area, and the dorsal raphe, inhibits them. And that promotes sleepiness and the onset of NREM. So there is this concept of this NREM flip-flop switch. That means just like an electrical button on-off between the VLPO and the orexin secreting neurons through the different structures involved in promoting wakefulness. So that's how the transition happens. What precisely brings about this switch is not yet known. Now, this is a little bit more complicated. How does the sleep from NREM switch to the REM sleep? And over here, several models are proposed. The one that I have shown over here is the model by Lou Fuller et al. In a nutshell, they propose there's an REM off area in the brain, which consists of the ventrolateral periaqueductal gray, which secretes the dopamine, and the lateral pontine tegmentum. And the REM on is consisting of the precocerebellus and the sublateral dorsal tegmentum. In a nutshell, this is an area somewhere in the brainstem. And both of these are interconnected through GABAergic inhibitory neurons. So this area, REM on, inhibits the REM off, and in turn, the REM off inhibits the REM on area through GABAergic neurons. Now, these REM off neurons, they are stimulated by the orexin secreting neurons, as well as the serotonin and the norepinephrine secreted by the dorsal raphe and the locus cerulus. And these REM off are kind of inhibited by the VLPO, the extended VLPO, and the PPT-LDT. So these are the rough structures. Now, when the PPT-LDT, that's the main one, it secretes acetylcholine and glutamate is the new one, it inhibits the REM off and it activates thereafter the REM on. When REM on is activated, these neurons secrete glutamate, one branch ascends to the thalamus and then to the brain, basal forebrain, and brings about the onset of the REM activity over here. And another branch goes down into the anterior horn cells in the spinal cord. And that's where glycine and GABA are there. And they inhibit these motor neurons. And that is what brings about the atonia, muscle atonia during the REM sleep. This is one direct mechanism. Second is it goes to the medulla. From the medulla, there's an inhibition of the locus cerulus. And locus cerulus is involved in maintaining or facilitating the muscle tone. So therefore, the dual mechanism of inhibition and what they call a disfacilitation between the medulla to locus cerulus inhibition brings about a motor atonia during REM sleep. Therefore, individuals in REM sleep have motor atonia, and rightly so, because they do not enact on their dreams. And during the REM behavior disorder, it is this descending tract from the SLD to the medulla and down to the motor neurons, which is damaged. And therefore, the individuals are actually able to enact. They don't have a muscle atonia. That is what is impaired in REM behavior disorders. And this model does not exactly explain how the switch between REM off and REM on happens. But this is just an overall view how transitions between NREM and REM sleep happens. So to summarize, between the wake and the different NREM and REM sleep, you have mainly the reticular activating system, which has locus cerulus and dorsal raphe nucleus and the PPT-LDT, secretion of acetylcholine, serotonin, norepinephrine, all three of them leads to a wake state and a fast cortical rhythm over here. When these two structures, the locus cerulus, dorsal raphe nucleus, are switched off by the REM on located in the PPT-LDT, you have the onset of slow wave sleep. And when there is a REM on, there is a REM sleep with muscle atonia. And of course, a thalamocortical rhythm which is going on. So this is a nutshell of how the wakefulness transition to NREM and to NREM sleep will happen. And this is an overview of the circuits. Don't be bogged down with the names on the slide on the right side. But in red over here are the wakefulness promoting circuit. In blue is the circuit which promotes sleepiness. And in yellow, which is the area located over here in the hypothalamus, is the circuit which is involved in transiting between the two states of wakefulness and sleep. Moving to the next slide. So now we have a look at sleep architecture. So this is the EEG patterns during wake. And over here, N1, N2, N3 is the American Academy of Sleep Medicine classification. It's not very radically different. Only difference is stage N1 is the classical stage 1, the stage 2. And stage 3 and 4 are clubbed into N3 over here. And finally, the REM sleep pattern. I won't delve into this detail because this is something we are not doing daily in our clinical practice. And a look at the the somnogram over here. You have the sleep onset and the latency, which is usually up to half an hour. And then the onset of NREM over here. And then roughly 90 minutes after the onset of sleep, you're the first REM cycle over here in red. And that usually lasts no more than 5 minutes. And then as the sleep progresses, so the first half of a sleep is mainly NREM. And the second half, you have predominance of REM activity, which occurs at a periodicity between 80 to 120 minutes. And on an average, 90 minutes, it keeps on recurring. And the same thing, which is summarized over here. One thing I have not gone into detail is there are two types of REM, tonic and phasic REM, which will be shown in the next slide. But what is important to remember is dreams in the first half of the night and any issues with them. So night terrors or sleepwalking, that's an NREM phenomena. And if you have dreams and nightmares in the second half of the sleep, these are mainly likely to be REM nightmares. And of course, I already touched upon REM behavior disorders. So the next slide shows the difference between the tonic REM and the phasic features. I'm not delving into this. It's self-explanatory on this slide. And I'll give you all a moment to have a look at it. Just one thing I'll touch over here is this pontogeniculate occipital wave. These are not captured in the surface electrode. You need a cortical electrode to capture these. And one other point is the irregular respiration heart rate, which occurs in the phasic feature. That is when often there can be precipitation of arrhythmias and sudden cardiac deaths during sleep. So now we come towards the end. What drives sleep? Now, I won't be going into details, but you have mainly two things, the homeostatic sleep drive, or as they call the process S. That means during the state of wakefulness, there is a buildup of a pressure on sleep, substances within the body, which tend to drive sleep. So these, one of them proposes adenosine, which acts on the adenosine receptor in the DLPO as well as the basal forebrain. And it inhibits, so the when it acts in the basal forebrain, it inhibits the neurons in the basal forebrain, which promote wakefulness in the cortex. And of course, in the VLPO, they will activate, and VLPO will thereafter inhibit the wakeful promoting structures in the brainstem, and that brings about onset of sleep. That's one process. This other one is the circadian process, or process C, as we call. And this is a topic in itself. Some time back, Dr. Malai Dave had given a very beautiful lecture on this. But in a nutshell, you have the central pacemaker, the suprachiasmatic nucleus, which tends to synchronize. And of course, here you have lots of clock genes and other genes involved, which tend to synchronize the rhythmicity and brings about a 24-hour variation and onset of sleep. And most importantly, motivational behavior. So that means if individuals are motivated not to sleep or motivated to sleep, that will also impact and cause whether the individual stays awake or goes to sleep. So this is on the left. In animals, we can see sleep depth, and also in humans, circadian time and also metabolic state. You can't sleep on a hungry stomach. That's also possible. And immune function. So when people have inflammation, it tends to have prostaglandin D2 and cytokines, which tend to facilitate sleep. And of course, that sleep is more NREM. REM is suppressed in that state. And of course, in animals, predation risk, mating opportunities, and seasonal and migratory status will also determine whether they sleep or they are remaining wakeful. And of course, in humans, a host of medical illnesses, psychiatric disorders, sleep disorders,
medicines, habits, and lifestyle can also affect sleep. The last slide, I would say, what are the changes? The second last slide, what are the changes across lifespan? So in newborns, you will notice they sleep long, maybe up to 17 hours, and REM sleep is the predominant rhythm in them. And as we age from infancy to adulthood to old age, the quantum of REM actually diminishes. That's one change. Secondly, overall in non-REM, the N3, that means the deep wave sleep, tends to reduce. And over here we can see rapid eye movement decreases, sleep efficiency reduces, the slow wave sleep also is reducing and worsening, more so in men. And the slow wave sleep amplitude is also diminishing. What is increasing is sleep latency, that means it takes longer to go to bed, frequent arousals, awakenings, and stage shifts. Stage 1 and stage N2, that is increasing, and napping during the day increases. Resistance to sleepiness and sleep deprivation happens. And of course, a phase advancement, that means the elderly tend to sleep very early, sometimes at 8 o'clock in the night, and tend to wake up very early in the morning, 3 o'clock. And that's physiological in some of them. And in this slide, we can see the quantum of REM is quite huge in utero at birth and tends to diminish, but is not eliminated. So this is where some authors have proposed that REM is responsible and very much needed for neuronal maturation and then subsequently throughout life for neuronal preservation. And in adolescence, you have a delayed sleep phase syndrome. So that's a circadian phase delay. That means they do not get sleep, let's say by 10 o'clock or 9 o'clock as they were sleeping previously. Suddenly they start sleeping at 12 o'clock, 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock. And then due to the pressure of academics or social networking or going to school, they have to wake up early. And this, they say, is the perfect storm. It's a physiological stress because they are sleep deprived. And that has consequences, but not in everybody. In those who are genetically vulnerable, this will definitely affect. And not every adolescent is going to have this delayed sleep phase syndrome. And for alteration of sleep with aging, I've already spoken in the previous slide, but this is a slide which summarizes all the changes that are happening with aging over here. So to summarize, sleep is an active process. So it's not a passive process. Different areas of the brain, chiefly the brainstem, hypothalamus, thalamus, basal forebrain areas are mainly involved in sleep and wakefulness, and different areas are active during different vigilance states, wakefulness or NREM or REM sleep. And this classification, or I would say dual bifurcation of NREM, REM sleep is present in all mammals. So it's constant, it's not just in humans. And the different neurotransmitters involved, I've listed down on the screen, I'm not going to repeat that. And you have the homeostatic sleep drive, the circadian rhythms, and the motivational behavior, which will drive either a sleep or a wakeful vigilant states. And multiple variables will affect sleep, and there are definitely changes in our sleep patterns and the quality of sleep over the lifespan. So these are all that I had to say, and I hope I have kept my time of 25 minutes. These are the references. Should you all be interested, you all can have a look at these. Thank you very much. Over to you back, Avinash.
Yeah. Well, thank you, Ashutosh, for a very crisp lecture. If anyone has any questions, I request you to just type them in the chat box. We have around 3 to 5 minutes for Ashutosh's questions before we go for questions for him before we go to our next speaker.
No questions mean either I was very good in explaining or I put everybody to sleep during the talk. No questions? Can I add one point, Avinash?
Please.
Okay, so, you know, I spoke about this hypocretin neurons, the orexin neurons, and they promote wakefulness. Just for information, I don't think this molecule is available in our country as of now, but there is a molecule being developed or already in market, suvorexant, if you all have heard about this. So it is acting as a dual receptor, orexin receptor antagonist. That means the orexin A and B, it tends to block this and it facilitates sleep. So this is a new possible therapy, I hope, in the coming years, which will be available in our country. But now we can understand that when we block the hypocretin, how it will promote sleep. So that's one point, since I was not getting any questions. And then I think if there are no further questions, you can continue with the next speaker then.
Yeah. No, and since you mentioned about sumorexant, I mean, I have heard about it, but I have no idea about it. Would it be like a very non-addictive kind of therapy, unlike benzodiazepines or any other thing? I'm just asking you from your knowledge.
Okay, my knowledge over here is a bit incomplete. I just paid attention to the fact that it is acting
on the acronym,
they call it DORA. So DORA, orexin receptor antagonist. So it reminds Doraemon, you know.
right. Sure. Well, I think there aren't any questions, Ashutosh, because it was a novel area for, I think, many clinicians, and it's been a good learning process for us. So thank you so much for taking time out. And we now move on to our next speaker. And our next speaker is Dr. Manasvi Gautam. He is, of course, a consultant psychiatrist in private practice from Jaipur. He is the chairperson of the media and Mental Health Committee of the Indian Psychiatric Society. He is also the co-chair of the Web and Social Media Committee of the Indian Association of Private Psychiatry. And he's a current secretary of the Indian Association of Private Psychiatry, Rajasthan State Branch. He has his own private practice and hospital in Jaipur. And most importantly, Manasvi is a very close friend, a very dear friend with whom I have been interacting over the past so many years. He's been associated with various organizations, including, I think, he's done a lot of work in geriatric mental health, where he has been a part of various positions with the Indian Association of Geriatric Mental Health. So Manasvi's topic is that he's primarily going to tell us about a clinical approach to an elderly patient with insomnia. So I hand over to you, Manasvi. You have around 25 minutes to present, following which we'll have question answers.
Thank you, Avinash. You have been very kind in introducing me. And good evening, everybody. Today, I have been assigned to talk about the clinical approach to an elderly patient with insomnia. So okay. So as we see that the population of older adults continue to expand rapidly from the current 205 million people aged over 60 years and is projected to be much, much higher, up to 2 billion by 2050. And 50% of older adults complain about difficulty initiating or maintaining sleep. Overall prevalence of insomnia symptoms range from 30% to 48% reported in various studies. And a study of 6,800 older adults, 65 years or older, observed an incidence rate of 5% per year of insomnia symptoms with a yearly incidence of 7.97% at 1 year follow-up. So looking at that, we see that the sleep efficiency continues to decrease past age 60 years. There is a prominent increase in wakefulness after the sleep onset, but no changes observed in sleep latency. Study on psychomotor vigilance, task performance. After several nights of sleep deprivation in women aged from 20 to 30 years compared to older women, found younger women had more prominent impairment with sleep. American Insomnia Survey of individuals of more than 10,000 individuals showed that the complaints of insomnia rates were lower in older adults. When we talk in lower adults, like those who are older than 75 above compared to the younger old. So evidence highlights that the importance of approaching any complaint of insomnia in the older population with more vigilance. Now, as we see, there are various types of disorders which have insomnia as their symptoms, right, from cardiovascular to respiratory to endocrine, gastroenterological, neurological pain, where chronic pain, and genitourinary, sleep itself, psychiatric conditions. So all of them contribute to insomnia. There are so many drugs which have their interactions with sleep cycle and like we have our psychiatric drugs, the cardiovascular drugs, the ACE inhibitors, the beta blockers, calcium channel blockers, respiratory medications like bronchodilators, neurological drugs, dopaminergic agents usually commonly used in Parkinson's, analgesics, gastrointestinal drugs, and others. So morbidity associated with insomnia. Insomnia is associated with significant morbidity. Strongest level of evidence is for mental illness. Recent study noted that 44% of the older patients with persistent insomnia continue to have depression 6 months later, as compared to only 16% of those without insomnia. Meta-analysis of insomnia symptoms and its association with heart disease after adjusting for age and other cardiovascular risk factors, identifying that the risk ratio for heart disease from insomnia symptoms ranged from 1.47 to 3.9. And studies has also demonstrated that people with insomnia are at greater risk for metabolic syndromes, neurological disorders, stroke, migraine, chronic pain, endocrine disorders, as we have just seen in the earlier table. They all worsen insomnia, and a meta-analysis of studies in adults of more than 60 years shows that insomnia is associated with a significant risk of all-cause dementia. So diagnosing insomnia, diagnostic criteria for chronic insomnia disorders, these are the ICD-3 and DSM-5 criteria. Sleep initiation or maintenance problems, more than 30 minutes, ample opportunities and circumstances to sleep, daytime effects, duration of 3 months and frequency more than three per week, and symptoms are not due to another sleep disorders like pain disorder or secondary to other psychiatric disorder. So if we see this in this table, initiation or maintenance, problems with initiation or maintenance, and we have, as we all know, initial insomnia, middle insomnia, and terminal insomnia are how we categorize it. In adequate opportunities for sleep not present, consider behaviorally induced insufficiency sleep, and if daytime consequences of insomnia are absent or no insomnia is present. Initial insomnia, rule out medical and psychiatric causes. Restless leg symptoms, consider RLS. Rule out medical in middle insomnia, rule out medical and psychiatric causes which are disturbing the MOTS. And if snoring is present, then we should consider SDB, sleep disorders due to breathing, affecting breathing. And if abnormal movement present, then we should consider rapid eye movement disorders. And in terminal insomnia, we have to rule out medical and psychiatric causes, and to see that the total sleep time is normal, consider advanced sleep wake phase disorders as one of your probable diagnosis. Now looking at the pharmacological treatments which are available to us, this is a list I have taken from the Indian Practice Guideline on management of sleep disorders in elderly. Looking one into one, benzodiazepines and non-benzodiazepine sedatives, as we have been prescribing them for a long time, benzodiazepine and non-benzodiazepine sedatives, we know that they work on the GABA type A receptors. And difference between the non-benzodiazepines are that they are more selective for the alpha-1 subclass of the receptors, which while causing sedation has minimal anxiolytic, amnestic, and anticonvulsant effects compared to that of the benzodiazepine. And sleep onset latency, number of nighttime awakening, and total sleep time and sleep quality in the short term are at par, but not with chronic use, as we know that due to habituation, later on, we need to escalate the dose in the benzodiazepines. In benzodiazepines, triazolam, short-acting benzodiazepine, FDA approved for short-term insomnia for use for 7 to 10 days, binds with GABA A receptor complex, and it is effective for both sleep onset and sleep maintenance in insomnia at a dose of 0.25 milligrams taken for 3 nights. Stage 2 NREM sleep is increased by 48 minutes. Stage 3 is increased by 6 minutes, which has been reported in various studies, while REM sleep minutes did not change. Side effects of triazolam in older adults include drowsiness, headache, dizziness, ataxia, nervousness, nausea, rebound amnesia, anterograde amnesia, psychological dependence, and anxiety. These are usually the side effects seen in most of the benzodiazepines. Chronic use of triazolam in elderly Japanese patients as seen in one of the studies significantly increased the risk for pneumonia by 40%, trauma by 30%, and pressure ulcers by almost 30%. Temazepam, again, FDA approved for short-term insomnia. It is used to treat sleep onset and sleep maintenance insomnia. 7.5 to 15 milligrams of doses may help improve sleep onset and sleep maintenance, but tolerance develops rapidly. Then the Z drugs, as zopiclone is a non-benzodiazepine hypnotic, FDA approved for sleep onset and sleep maintenance insomnia. It is restricted in elderly as it increases stage 2 NREM sleep. RCTs in the elderly suggest improvement in the sleep onset and sleep maintenance and daytime function with short term and up to 12 weeks of use. Recommended doses, 1 milligram in the elderly may help sleep onset, but if sleep maintenance is a significant problem, then we have to consider increasing the dose up to 2 milligrams. And intermittent dosing is preferred, but in the small subgroup of elderly patients who require longer term hypnotic therapy, azathioprine may be an alternative. Zolpidem, it also acts on the GABA-A complex, effective for sleep initiation, midnight awakening, and sleep maintenance problems are well taken off. Depending on the formulation chosen, it should not be used for midnight awakening. It's having side effects like headache, somnolence, dizziness, nausea, diarrhea, myalgia, and including sleepwalking and sleep driving. Zaleplon is again targeting the GABA-A receptors, alpha-1, beta-2, gamma-2, alpha-2 and alpha-3 subunits. FDA approved for short-term use in insomnia, use for sleep onset insomnia, midnight awakening, provided there are still at least 4 hours remaining. The dose in the elderly is 5 milligram, taken immediately before bedtime or after the patient has gone to bed and has experienced difficulty falling asleep. The benefits appear to be sustained even with prolonged use. Now, many times we use antidepressants, various antidepressants, including the phenylpiperazine compounds, the dextroamphetamine or tricyclic antidepressants, doxepin, and SSRIs like serotonergic antidepressant like mirtazapine, a novel antidepressant, have sedating properties and are often used for the treatment of insomnia. Trazodone is widely prescribed for insomnia in doses of 25 to 100 milligrams. Study on trazodone comparing its effect with zolpidem in 21 to 65 years old shows it has similar efficacy for sleep latency and sleep efficiency, which with these effects dissipating after the first week. And adverse events such as dizziness, cardiac arrhythmias, orthostatic hypotension, and potential priapism can be significant in the elderly population. Histamine receptors antagonist, doxepin. Low dose doxepin is a sedating tricyclic antidepressant. Doxepin usually used in 1, 3, and 6 milligram doses shows efficacy in treating sleep maintenance insomnia with decreased VASO and on PSG. It's seen an increased PSG SE and duration of sleep. Low dose doxepin improves sleep continuity and sleep duration and appears to be a good alternative for elderly insomniacs with sleep maintenance problems. Remeltion, this is also FDA approved for treatment of insomnia. It significantly reduces the patient's report of sleep latency over 5 weeks of treatment with no significant rebound insomnia or withdrawal effects as seen usually with benzodiazepines. it is not associated with dependence, mammary dysfunctions, and nocturnal gait instability in older people. Now, suvorexant is the first FDA-approved dual orexin receptor antagonist and may be prescribed up to a 20 milligram of dose. It targets wakefulness promoting neuropeptides that regulate the sleep-wake cycle, demonstrating its efficacy in decreasing sleep latency and in increasing the total sleep time. It has been studied in both elderly and non-elderly patient population, identifying no significant efficacy or safety differences between these two age groups. Although it is well tolerated by older adults, long-term data are still lacking. Then orexin receptors for receptor antagonists. It's more useful for suvorexant. It's more useful for sleep maintenance insomnia. And studies have shown that in combination with the CBTI, it has shown better efficacy. Although it has also seen that people have daytime somnolence with it, so caution of driving precautions are mentioned. Now, there are certain newer drugs which are there coming into pipeline, the DORAs, dual orexin receptor antagonists. The oral almorexant shows significant dose-related improvement in mean vaso. And in doses of 200, 150, and 225 milligrams, it has been studied respectively compared with placebo. Lamborexant, another DORA, underwent a double-blind placebo-controlled parallel group trial in 291 adults and elderly adults with a mean age of 49 years who were randomized to the drug versus to placebo for a combined efficacy and safety trial. Pilorexant, a DORA with short T-half of 3 to 6 hours, underwent a phase 2 double-blind placebo-controlled trial, 2-4-week period adaptive crossover PhD study in 324 adults, doses of 10 and 20 milligrams, improved the LPS compared to with placebo. Somnolence was the most common adverse effect reported. Now, non-pharmacological treatment, as we see in all the guidelines, non-pharmacological treatment is given weightage over the pharmacological treatment. Here we have usually two treatment modalities here, cognitive behavior therapy for insomnia, CBTI, and brief behavioral treatment for insomnia. There are also behavioral therapy, which is there. CBTI is more elaborate, which talks about the stimulus control, sleep restriction, relaxation technique, and sleep hygiene. While brief behavioral treatment for insomnia talks only about stimulus control and sleep restriction. And it's a shorter version for having 4 sessions, while CBTI requires 6 to 20 sessions. So all in all, there are these various treatment modalities which are available to us. So in class, I like to say that insomnia is a very prevalent problem in the older adults. Using the history and physical examination along with the insomnia scales, clinicians can evaluate and treat insomnia in our rapidly aging population. Behavioral and cognitive behavioral therapies offer very effective longer duration treatment and are recommended as first-line treatment options for insomnia compared to the hypnotic medications in older adults. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Manasvi. That was indeed a very good presentation. If anyone has any questions, I would request them to just please come up with the questions. You can type them in the chat box or you can raise your hand to ask the question. Since there are not many questions, I would like to say that it was a great learning experience today by Dr. Ashutosh, where he talked about in great detail the neurobiology of sleep, and Dr. Manasvi, who taught us about sleep hygiene and the other techniques about the medications related to insomnia. Thank you everyone for today's session. I, Dr. Priyanka Mahajan, on behalf of Bombay Psychiatric Society, would like to thank Dr. Ashutosh and Dr. Manasvi to accept our request to give a wonderful speech today. And there is a comment in the, there is a question in the chat box. I would like to just read it out. One second. What would be the recommended treatment of insomnia in elderly clients with moderate to severe dementia? If Dr. Manasvi can throw some light on that.
In moderate to severe dementia, as we know that the cognition is already impaired. In such a scenario, one, the choice of treatment would be the Z drugs, rather azathioprine, as we have seen. And in that also, we initiate initially with 1 milligram. And if there is a difficulty in maintaining the sleep, then only we'll go up to 2 milligram. Usually that is how we go about it, because the cognition anyways is an issue.
Thank you so much. There is another question. What is the role of prophylactic melatonin in elderly in order to prevent sleep disorder, since OTC melatonin is gaining popularity?
I have had a limited use of melatonin recently, used in certain patients. But although it has been talked about and hyped a lot, but clinically it's not been such advantageous. I have not seen it. Maybe others who have used it might throw some light on it, because to the few patients which I have tried upon, I have not seen it to be very, very clinically effective.
So just a small experience. I am not that experienced as you people are, but I've been recently using melatonin in patients who've come with a lot of sleep disturbances, especially with the sleep phase shift cycles because of COVID and lockdown, people watching Netflix and Amazon Prime for a long time. And in them, melatonin has helped a bit. So, I mean, I have practically used it. If anyone else can share their experience, we'll be more than happy to know about it. Also, there is a question. If a client has recurrent nightmares, what would be the treatment recommended? If you or Dr. Ashutosh, anyone can answer.
Manasvi, go ahead. What would you like to say for, yeah?
Yes, sir.
Those people who are having this problem, usually basically it's due to difficulty in maintaining of the sleep. So in that, again, the treatment of choice would be a DORA drug rather than anything else, because that takes good care of the maintenance part. And if at all we have because it's not difficulty with sleep initiation, rather with the maintenance thing. And CBTI, I think, is again a treatment of choice, because here you are talked about and taught about how to, when to sleep into bed and when to not be there in bed when you are having these problems, and that conditioning and behavioral activation. So that part again is good, and a combination of both of them works wonder.
Dr. Priyanka?
Yes.
Yeah. Dr. Ashutosh, yeah?
Yes, Ashutosh. Yes.
Yeah. What was the question? Can you remind me?
The patients having nightmares, what would be the drug of choice?
Okay, so it depends. Usually nightmares are an REM behavior, REM phenomena. And over here, you give clonazepam, a benzodiazepine, to help address this nightmares. And if still there is an issue, then subsequently a sleep study can be done to figure out. And of course, the routine clinical history to know if there are any substance use disorders which are happening. What exactly is the issue over here?
Yeah. Ashutosh, there's one question for you from Dr. Sukwani. I mean, what about the use of low-dose quetiapine in patients with dementia? You think it has some role? I mean,
Sorry, Dr. Manasvi, you would like to go ahead?
Yeah, Manasvi, you can answer first, and then I think Ashutosh will add on. Yeah.
Sure.
Low dose of quetiapine, I think it has been very fondly accepted by all clinicians now, and maybe to, 10 milligrams to 25 milligrams, as low as that, also has good sedative property. And more so in those people like who are having insomnia secondary to other psychiatric conditions, there we can look at these options, which are much better than, rather than having pure insomnia. Because anyways, giving a antipsychotic, even in low dose, in geriatric population can sometimes be a dicey thing where it can lead to maybe a akathisia or any other kind of complication. Dr. Ashutosh, whatever you would like to add.
Thanks. Yeah. So it all depends on what is the target or the purpose for giving low dose quetiapine. So one, we have the behavioral and psychological symptoms of dementia. Second, there could be insomnia along with that. And what Dr. Manasvi correctly pointed out, there is an increased risk of side effects due to the antipsychotics. And quetiapine low dose would often be given more for sedation purposes at nighttime. It can be used, and one needs to be cautious because it can cause hypotension. Then if the individual has underlying cardiac problems, it can also lead to prolongation of QTC. And finally, one needs to be aware that it cannot be just an indiscriminate use, like you would give quetiapine in the doses of 100, 200 milligrams. So low dose would be up to 50 milligrams. And sometimes it may not suffice because the whole problem that is happening, it's a neurodegenerative disorder. The dementia is just a symptom. And the sleep promoting areas, the wake promoting areas, they may all go haywire. So it's not a panacea cure that giving low dose quetiapine would always be helpful. Hello? That's all from my side.
Okay. I will just add a little to what Priyanka mentioned about melatonin. I mean, I think I have used it a lot, and sometimes 3 mg is not enough. We've gone up to 6 mg and even 9 mg in patients. And melatonin is also available by some companies as a syrup, as a nasal spray. So it's something which can work in patients. And it's a safe drug, non-addictive. So it's something, and it's somehow a milder sedative. So people prefer it compared to, but then again, I always believe that unless we don't really know whether melatonin is deficient. So we have some patients where it works and some patients where it doesn't work.
So there's another question which says that other than medication, how can we deal with insomnia in elderly person with cancer and COPD-like condition?
As we see that cancer and COPD like condition, if we'll like to split both into two different parts because both have got a different approach. If I talk about cancer, usually I have to see that is it the pain which is the key factor which is leading to insomnia, or it's the anxiety associated and the anxiety and depression which is that due to this debilitating condition, that is the key reason for insomnia. So looking at the factors, what is main factor, we have to choose the drug. So if it is the pain, then maybe the management of the pain itself. And sometimes many people of them receive morphine in end stage cancer. And that again, it's very high sedative in itself. So if that is the scenario, then pain has to be managed. And still, if insomnia persists, then we can give benzodiazepines. But in COPD patients, I would not like to prefer benzodiazepine because anyways, benzodiazepine are going to worsen it. So in that, maybe esopiclone or zolpidem would be a drug of choice.
Thank you.
in those patients.
Well, I don't see any more questions. So I think on behalf of Bombay Psychiatric Society, I would like to thank, of course, Manasvi, who has joined us all the way from Jaipur, though virtually, but he's still with us. And Ashutosh from here, our very own Mumbai-based psychiatrist, for their excellent talks. I also thank all my EC members who've always been behind me in support, and y'all are the fuel beneath my wings, I always say that. So y'all are always there. And well, just two small announcements. One is that we have two more programs this week, and these were fixed earlier, so they are back to back. On the 17th evening, we have a program on bipolar disorder where we have two lectures. One is on the neurobiology of bipolar for clinicians by Dr. Malay Dave. And Dr. M.S. Reddy from Hyderabad will speak about challenges in the management of mania. So that's going to be happening on the 17th. On the 18th, we have a full-fledged program on psychiatric rehabilitation, which will basically take place from 6 to 9:30 in the evening. And we're going to have one MMC credit for that. So we'll have various facets of rehab, right from daycare to inpatient to long-term rehab to challenges in the administration aspect and legal aspect, where we have Dr. Fabian, Dr. Anita Sukwani, Dr. Sanjay Kumawat, Dr. Amar Shinde, Dr. Ronnie, who runs the Chaitanya Center, and Dr. S. Kalyan Sundaram, who are our speakers. So it's a long event, but it's one credit hour, so that's our main event on Sunday. So those are our upcoming events for now. And just for your knowledge, on the 27th of July, we wanted to have it as an evening time, but it wasn't possible and feasible to the organizers. So at 2 p.m., we will be having the clinical meet, the regular BPS clinical meet by the Department of Psychiatry at KM Hospital and SAGS Medical College. We'll get back to you with all those details soon to come. Before we end this program, we want to thank the InnoVex division of IPCA for their support to this program. And Dr. Vaidehi, who's their chief medical officer, would like to probably speak to us for just 1 minute before we wind up.
Thank you so much, Dr. D'Souza. I am Dr. Vaidehi from IPCA. And
ma'am, you're unmuted. If you can unmute yourself, you're muted.
Okay. Yeah, sorry. Yes. Thank you, doctor. I am Dr. Vaidehi Purvankar from IPCA. And first of all, I'd like to congratulate the eminent speakers, Dr. Shah and Dr. Gautam, for excellent deliberation on sleep therapy, and not only in a very lucid language and covering every detail, I would say. It was certainly insightful. I would like to give a big thank you to the organizers, Bombay Psychiatric Society, for giving us this amazing platform to facilitate this platform, which has really enriched us all today with the insights of sleep therapy. I would take this opportunity to actually tell you that IPCA has now launched this new division of InnoVex with a focus on psychiatric products and neurological products. So in various therapy areas, so in sleep therapy also, we have Zolpidem brands of Sove with a unique patented technology and various others, certainly. And I'm sure that you all will extend your support. But I would like here to assure all Bombay Psychiatric Society and Dr. Suzu D'Souza and everybody that we would always be excited to be a part of such enriching discussions ahead. Thank you so much for giving me an opportunity to express myself. Have a great evening. Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much. And the IPCA will be working with us on three more programs, which will happen on a bi-monthly basis. So our next sleep program is going to be in September. We will get back to you with details. Okay. So it's been a good evening. And hopefully after listening to these two lectures, we will have a good night's sleep today, thinking of Ashutosh and Manasvi. So wishing you all the best and have a great evening. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Avinash.